Good morning. Merry Christmas. Please rise and join us in our opening hymn, O Come All Ye Faithful.
So face coverings are required at all times, and they must be worn over your nose and mouth. Please remain 6 feet away from members of other households whenever possible. We will not hold hands during the Our Father, and the sign of peace will not be observed at this time. If you brought hand sanitizer, please use it right before communion, and an usher will dismiss your row for communion. We ask that everyone comes forward so no one climbs over anyone else in the pews. And as you make your way forward, please use the marks on the floor to maintain physical distance. When you get to the front of the line, stand 6 feet away from the minister, respond amen, remove your face covering, and then come forward to receive communion. If you are not receiving communion, please cross your arms over your chest and the minister will give you a blessing. And then please put your face covering back on before returning to your seat. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
My dear sisters and brothers in Christ, the great mystery of salvation that we celebrate is that God's only begotten Son became flesh and dwells among us. We now pause to ponder this great mystery and reflect on whether we have been open to the salvation that our loving God offers us. Lord Jesus, you are the Word made flesh who dwells among us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the true light that dispels darkness. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you share the glory of the Father, full of grace and truth. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
O God, who wonderfully created the dignity of human nature, and still more wonderfully restored it, grant, we pray, that we may share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings glad tidings, announcing peace, bearing good news, announcing salvation, and saying to Zion, your God is King. Hark, your sentinels raise a cry. Together they shout for joy, for they see directly before their eyes the Lord restoring Zion. Break out together in song, O ruins of Jerusalem, for the Lord comforts his people. He redeems Jerusalem. The Lord has bared his holy arm in the sight of all the nations. All the ends of the earth will behold the salvation of our God. The word of the Lord.
Psalm 98 proclaims, all the ends of the earth have seen the saving power of God, the saving power of God.
A reading from the letter of the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, in times past, God spoke in partial and various ways to our ancestors through the prophets. In these last days, he has spoken to us through the Son, whom he made heir of all things, and through whom he created the universe, who is a refulgence of his glory and the very imprint of his being, and who sustains all things by his mighty word. When he accomplished purification through sins, he took his seat at the right hand of the majesty on high, as far superior to the angels, as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my son, on this day I have begotten you"? Or again, "I will be father to him, and he will be son to me"? And again, when he leads the firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all the angels of God worship him." The word of the Lord.
Is there anybody out there? Hey, this is my fifth Mass, and I was just thinking, I'm hoping the Lord will forgive me because I just gave you the shorter version of the gospel raising. So I think he'll be okay with that. But I do want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas. You know, sometimes, as I've said many times now, that phrase sometimes can start to sound like it's just a throwaway line or just a cliche. But I sincerely mean it. I hope everyone is having and will have a Merry Christmas. And you're experiencing as much joy, and I'm sure many of you are just as tired as I am, but experiencing that joy through kind of this fatigue that we're having. It's been quite a year, but we're here. And it's been a busy season, a chaotic season, with all sorts of pressures, like we have during the Christmas season. But then you put on that layer of the pandemic, and oh my gosh. So it's wonderful that we're here on this day to celebrate and come together to give thanks to God for the greatest gift of all, a gift that was first given 2,000 years ago, yet a gift we can, in a very real sense, unwrap for the very first time on this day, this celebration. You see, the same Jesus who was born over 2,000 years ago is the exact same Jesus who comes to us every time our hearts are open to him, particularly during this season of grace and the season of true miracle. And what we are celebrating this day is really something quite astounding. And that's an understatement, because you could never really give it its full glory of what we are celebrating this day. But if we think about it, and that is the key, thinking about and contemplating what this day really means. We're so familiar with it that it's easy for us to accept it without hanging on to the pure wonder of it all, without marveling at the mystery of it all, and without having a true appreciation for what God has done for us. What could possibly make our God want to become one of us, to dwell among us, to be the Word made flesh, as we hear the gospel reading? You know, I don't know the exact answer for that. That's a mystery that's only in the mind of God. But God, our God is a loving God. And we need to reflect on the incarnation to help us understand a little bit more about God. And in doing so, we really become to understand more about ourselves, since we are all made in the likeness and image of God. You know, God could have made an infinite number of other choices, but he chose this way, these circumstances, and this particular moment in history. There's nothing random about God, nothing coincidental. This was God's loving plan from the beginning. And that means it was the best plan, the best way, and the best for us and for all the world. But why this way, we might ask ourselves. What are we to make of all of this on God's great plan for us? Well, for one thing, the fact that God came to us as a helpless child, to a family of no status and no power, shows us that our God is a God of gentleness, not a God of force, not a God of coercion or of violence, but one of gentleness. He's a God of humility, not a God of arrogance. He's a God who doesn't want to be distanced, but wants to be close. He's a God who is not disinterested, but who is profoundly concerned with his creation, profoundly concerned for you and for me. Brothers and sisters, our God is an incredibly caring God, one willing to do absolutely anything and everything to lead us where we need to be, to heal every wound, to dry every tear, to forgive every sin. You see, the birth of Jesus doesn't reveal just one thing about God. It illuminates for so much of us, for us so much that had been in darkness for such a long time. So put another way, light
that light that has come into the world shines its radiant light on us and all of creation, but also, in a sense, shines it on himself, helping humankind see God in a whole new light, a whole new way, and from an entirely new and fresh perspective. God is so much more than we could ever imagine. And Christmas shows us that loud and clear. And if I had to try to sum up these holy mysteries in one phrase, which I know is really an impossibility, I'd probably say that when God came, became one of us in the person of Jesus, he changed absolutely everything. Nothing would ever be the same. The birth of Jesus was a turning point, a life-changing and world-changing reversal of the highest order. Humanity had been on one path, and Jesus altered that path forever. The world had been repeating a pattern of disobedience, but Jesus would be perfectly obedient to his Father. The world had too often given in to selfishness, but Jesus would be selfless. The world could not keep itself from turning on itself and on one another. Jesus would show us how to live, how to give, and how to love. God became part of his creation, and creation was never and has never been the same. That means that God, who became one of us, in the hope that we would never be the same either. That's the point. That's the other point of this Christmas miracle. He became like us so that we could be like him, gentle and humble and loving. That means that when God plunged himself right into our world in the most profound and intimate way possible, when God chose to be born of Mary, he did not simply do this to reverse the course of human history. He did it so precisely so that at the exact same time, everything could happen that happened to him in the human heart. And that human heart and the divine heart came together like no one could ever imagine. And when that came together, we became divine, open to his love, his grace, and his mercy. Brothers and sisters, God has changed the world. But here's the question that always is posed to us, and especially for us to meditate on this Christmas. God changed the world. Will we let him change us? Will we let his love transform our hearts and our minds and our souls? When that happens, that's when the real miracle occurs. Allowing Jesus to be born in each one of us so that people everywhere can still experience him and experience his blessings through us. And so, as we lovingly reflect on this beautiful story of Christmas, as we gratefully reflect on the tiny baby, Jesus, lying in the manger, let's never forget that the manger he really wants to lie in. And brothers and sisters, there is a manger that he desires beyond all desire to lie in. And that manger is the one of every human heart. So let us make room for him. Let us rededicate ourselves to him, especially during this most holy of times. Make room for him so he can do what he wants to do for us and for the world. That is to change the world, and so the world knows more closely his love and his goodness. Brothers and sisters, in just a very short moment, we'll be praying in our creed, and there's a special instruction for us during this time of Christmas that recognizes and praises Jesus for all he did, how he lowered himself to become one of us, the Word dwelling with us in the flesh. And so, in special praise of Jesus, during the creed, we'll all kneel momentarily at the words, "And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate." Please rise now. Let us pray what we believe. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Love has come down to earth, and God has indeed visited all people. Let us now offer our prayers to our loving God, who is faithful to every promise.
For the Church, that she may be the light to the world and draw all near to herself, we pray to the Lord. For leaders of governments around the world, that they may look after the welfare of all their citizens, especially the poor and the powerless, we pray to the Lord. For those who are alienated from the Church for whatever reason, that they may come to find in us understanding, compassion, and care, we pray to the Lord. For guests who join us and worship them on this holy day, that they may find in our faith community a welcoming home, we pray to the Lord. For the sick and those who care for them, that they may receive the spirit of hope, we pray to the Lord. For the health and well-being of Norma Seedorf, and for all her intentions, we pray to the Lord. For all our beloved dead, may they receive the reward of a life well spent and come to share in the fullness of Christ's glory. We pray to the Lord. For all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all our intentions, spoken and unspoken. We pray to the Lord.
Glorious God, we rejoice in the gift of your Son, whose birth into this world broke the barrier between heaven and earth. May the prayers we make here on earth be heard by you in heaven. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Make acceptable, O Lord, our oblation on this solemn day, when you manifested the reconciliation that makes us wholly pleasing in your sight, and inaugurated for us the fullness of divine worship through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, we're on the feast of this awe-filled mystery. Though invisible in his own divine nature, he has appeared visibly in arms and begotten before all ages. He has begun to exist in time, so that raising up in himself all that was cast down, he might restore unity to all creation and call straying humanity back to the heavenly kingdom. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. So that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes.
celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, by whose constant intercession in your presence, we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and David, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you've summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow in the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. We may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter the room, but only say the word of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, O merciful God, that just as the Savior of the world, born this day, is the author of divine generation for us, so he may be the giver even of immortality, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
A couple of brief announcements. Christmas time, brothers and sisters, is only just beginning. Our parish is providing free resources to help you celebrate the octave of the whole liturgical season, including a Christmas playlist from our Director of Sacred Music, blessings, prayers, family activities, and more. So please visit lanecatholic.org or stop at the welcome desk for more information. And our parish's virtual Christmas cards are now available to watch on our website and Facebook page. Thank you to everyone who sent a video message. And please help us share this video greeting with as many parishioners as possible, especially those who are home-based, self-isolated, or in assisted living facilities. Finally, before our departing instructions, I just want to wish everyone again a very, very Merry Christmas. I hope you have a safe Christmas, and hopefully we'll have a brighter new year this year. I took that from a card that somebody gave me. Have a brighter new year. I thought that was appropriate. All right, when Mass is over, which it is, an usher is going to dismiss you row by row, beginning in the back. We encourage you to visit with others, but please, if you're going to do so, do that outside at a safe physical distance. I know it's still a little bit cold out there. There is a podium in the narthex where you can drop off your offering, and you can also give to our parish on our website via text message or through the mail. And finally, please dispose of your worship aid in one of the bins on the tables in the narthex. The Lord be with you. Bow down for the blessing. May the God of infinite goodness, who by the incarnation of his Son has driven darkness from the world, and by that glorious birth has illumined this most holy day, drive far from you the darkness of vice, and illumine your hearts with the light of virtue. Amen. May God, who willed that the great joy of his Son's saving birth be announced to the shepherds by the angel, fill your minds with the gladness he gives, and make you heralds of his gospel.
Amen.
And may God, who by the incarnation brought together the earthly and heavenly realm, fill you with the gift of his peace and favor, and make you sharers with the church in heaven.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in singing our closing hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.